You're a bit lucky, I hope, because for the previous two times that I gave this presentation, I had only 20 minutes, and now I have a little bit longer, so I can answer more questions. So maybe you can even get to some discussions. And Guido is here as well. If you have seen his presentation, he also mentioned GetText, which is for translations, and he knows much more about translations than I do. But I have, you will see that I made some very practical extensions to simplify the application of translations in Template Toolkit. But before we reach those slides, at the end of this talk, we will see quite a number of other modules, which are the base of my final product. So at least five or six other components, I will discuss them with you, and don't hesitate to interrupt me and ask questions, probably even in German. I understand German, but don't ask me to speak German back to you unless you feed me a lot of beer. So, translations. Who have ever tried to make translations in a web application or just command line applications? Well, hands? Who did translations? No one? We'll try to implement translations in your web framework. One, two, three. Ah, finally. Look. Okay. If you start a new application and you want to make it translatable, that's easy. But on the moment you have an old application, like I have to maintain for a government at the moment, and you have the applications and you have to transform that into a translatable application, it's quite complex. The step you have to make is, instead of using interpolation of variables wherever you print them, inline print them, or in via templates print them, then you have to make it translatable. You have to reorganize your print statements. You have to use printf, for instance, print formatted. I hope everyone knows how it works. Printf is already ancient POSIX, Unix statement. You can use this in all programming languages, printf, even in the shell. You have to reorganize the printing of your string. Variables are interpolated by the printf command. Yeah, and not as in Perl style. Why? Well, you have to be able to call a translation function. A translation from, in this case, an English text into Dutch, German, and so on. And if you have this, the name of the variable filled in, then it is dynamic. The content changes. So it's too late for the function to look it up. And that's quite an effort. So it's quite an effort to transform your existing programs into something what is translatable. A nice way. Well, there's the GNU GetText framework, which is often used. It has a GetText command. You can find this on all platforms. And you are the maintainer of GetText, you said? GNU GetText?
That part.
Oh, the Perl part. Okay. But it's a huge infrastructure. And the nice thing is that also in Perl, we have a few modules which can be used to do this lookup in that standard framework with PO files and so on. I will show you a little bit later. This is GetText framework. It uses files which are called PO file. That's, I don't know.
Portable objects.
Portable objects. Yeah. Very useful name.
It was invented by Solaris.
Yeah. It's ancient, really, at least 20 years old, maybe 25 years old, maybe even older. And you have a file names like this, where the first is the domain name. That's the table set. It's usually the application name. And then you have usually a character set, or if it is not specified, then it is in, system native for some encoding. And you have a language for the translation table. And this is a Dutch translation to Dutch in how they speak it in Holland and not in Belgium, because that's BE. And then the PO. These PO files, they contain the text from your source. And then you have to add by hand or by one of the many tools the translation into your in that language, in that specific language. It's quite verbose. There is also MO files, that's binary format. So if you have PO files, you can compile them, and then it's much lighter. Well, the printf, which is the percent s as positional parameter to fill it in, is quite it's not optimal for translators, because translators only see your PO file; they don't see the code directly usually. So it's much more nicer if you would have a name instead of just a percent s. And well, PO files are actually not sensitive for the syntax you're using. Some do highlighting for curly braces, look up anything you want. So many modules use curly braces instead of positional fields. And so this is then your message ID, what you saw as a printf. And if you look at locally text domain, I think that's the most used translation module in Perl 5. Then they introduce a function that's called __x. And that's the same as getText, what you saw in the previous slide, the original name. And there are many versions, __xn, if you have a count in it, and so on. So it's quite brief. And so this is the lookup function, and then you print it, and the lookup function. Well, this is a read round parenthesis here. So this is a function which looks up the string, the message ID, to be translated, and fills in the parameters inside the curly braces. You cannot use single quotes here. You have to use double quotes. Do you know why? You know? Yeah, a single quote is the old notation for a namespace separator. So if you use round parentheses, it's okay. But if you avoid these parentheses, then you have to use double quotes. Yeah, of course, in this case, you also need this backslash n to be a new line. But anyway, and then so this is how the PO file looks like with the translations, but now not positional, but with a nice clean names. You cannot translate the name, of course. That's not. It still should be a user in the result. Okay, let's sidetrack. Many years ago, I wrote a module which is called LogicBoard, and I use it for all my modules, all my large modules. And I really like to program. I really love the program, and I do it for many, many years. And what I discovered is that three things are very, very closely related. And usually, those three things are in three lines after another, all the time. The three things which are very closely related are logging, or producing output, exceptions, die, warn, which has a message, and translations, because you have a message and it must be translated. So what I produced was a module which makes that very simple to do it in one line instead of three lines, in three different actions, just one action. And for instance, here, this is a standard Perl. I open the file for reading, and I die with an error message. But the die is an exception, and this is a text string. And there's something special with this exception. It has something to do with outside information, operating system information for the error code. And well, if it is going to an end user on the screen, a website or so, then we might want to have some translation in here as well. And the other thing is that Perl is quite poor. We have only this exception three exception levels: print and warn and die, and only three. And if you go to other logging infrastructures or other operating system or other programming languages, Or if you want to write output to syslog, for instance, or loglog for Perl, you have many more levels than those three. So log report adds additional levels to your program. And I will show you later a little bit how to connect the logging, what log report is producing, with other output mechanisms like syslog. So the new keywords which are introduced by log report are, well, a print is already exist, a trace, for instance, and assert, info, notice, a little bit more important, we grow in importance a bit, warning, but still not dying, and then four different versions of fatal things. Oh, I missed mistake, that's also one of the things. Errors, that means it's an internal error. I define error as an internal error, and fault is an external error, operating system error. And alert means it's a real error, but I can continue. And panic means confess, or in the CARP namespace. And these, so you have more levels, and they map much nicer to, for instance, syslog output, but also loglog for Perl and so on. What is one of the advantages that you configure the output, so where the destination of your log, in your main program and not in your module. So you can have all kinds of different modules installed from CPAN, and only your main program decides where the logging is going through. You can even say, I want to log in Chinese to the website, display the message, translate to Chinese, but in English to syslog at the same time. And the other thing is that in log report, you start it as a mode, and you can turn on high level just debug mode, and then an error will produce you a stack trace, and the trace message will be shown. But on main level, if you just say, I run a normal mode, then all trace messages will disappear. So you don't have to write if verbose, for instance, 5,000 times in your program for all your debug messages. So it's a bit smarter in this behavior. So in standard Perl, you would write die. And the die, it has something to do with an open. Open is an operating system thing. And that's why you produce your error message here as well. Include your error message. In with log report, you write fault. We can forget this for a moment. But fault means some external cause. It automatically includes the dollar exclamation mark in the message. Because that's the purpose of fault. If it didn't have that, then you should use error as function. And so this is the first step. And then in your main program, you tell where the errors of all your modules you're using are going to. And there's one standard dispatch for open in the beginning, which has its name default. If you reopen it with the same name with a different dispatcher, then that one will be closed. But the default dispatcher is called Perl, and that simply will call warn and die, print warn and die. Yeah. So that's how it works around. So we use another function name, and if you do nothing, the default will still be just a die. Okay, well, so this is a first step. In one of the previous slides, we saw this. This will enable, underscore, underscore, X will enable translations. If you do not have translation tables, and then it will just be a no-op. It's exactly the same with or without this underscore, underscore, the result. Actually, this is quite complex. Internally, it's quite complex. Internally, this is how you use it in the program. Your module belongs to a certain namespace. You know, these translation table names, the domain name. And your error message is this. So this is what you will find in your PO file. This red part will cause translations, and also that the variables will get filled in. and the fault will cause an exception. And you can leave translations out. You can use die if you want to with translations. You can use, there are three components, but they are all optional. But it's very convenient to use them together. Actually, what happens, it's internally is quite complex. So this fault function will create an exception object. It's a fault, it's an exception. So a message which is thrown up the stack. And the exception of type fault. And it gets a message object because __x creates a message to be translated later. This is the message ID to be looked up later. It automatically, well, it takes the variables to be filled in. It automatically takes the translation table from the file, the PM file, where it is, where you found the string in. And it collects the file name and line number and even a stack trace. So on the moment you die or so, it just collects some of the fault exception. It collects some very convenient information. And so the big difference between other translation frameworks and LockReport is that the translation is and how to handle this exception is postponed as long as possible. It's not handled here. Only there is an object created, an exception object with a message, an untranslated message. So if you catch it somewhere with a try, if you catch this exception, then you can also inspect it. You can see where it happens. Maybe you want to ignore it. It's still untranslated, so it's very easy to see which exception happened. And you can add all kinds of tags. You can say just label the exceptions and process them. Everything what is labeled by website will appear on the website, but if the exception doesn't have a label website, then it will only go to syslog or something like that. So okay, let me see. I used this for a long time, and this interpolation. So this is another sidestep I will make. This interpolation of these variables inside strings is far more useful than I thought. I mean, printf, as we have in Unix for 30 years, is quite primitive. I wanted to be a bit more. I had more plans for this. And if we can make this smarter, the interpolation smarter, we can maybe use this in the translation tables in a very smart way and make it more convenient there. I will show you in the next slide. First I have to explain how you can catch the exception. So you have a try, and LockReport has its own try function. And all these modules like try tiny and so on, they are nearly all the same. They are just a hidden eval. And they are just somewhere eval, and then you have the error in $add, and then they make in kind of tricks with $add. And you may not know, but the $add is usually, the text called by eval, is usually a string, but it doesn't need to be. It can be an object. So in the try produced by LockReport, but also with other try implementations, they usually return a heavily overloaded object. So, for instance, you can ask any object, did I die? What was the last exception you got? Can you collect all my trace messages in between in this try block? So this $add is, in this case especially, it's quite a tricky thing. For instance here, was fatal. So I want to have the exception which was in $add, which was fatal. And if $add was not did not die, it's just false, just returning false. That's our tricks you can play with overloading and so on. So if this the try block, what was just called here before, if it produced a fatal exception, then I want it to be translated into some language. Yeah? Let me see. Okay, the message must be translated. I want to see it on the screen because it was fatal. I want to see it somewhere, and I use print. So this interpolation, I decided to separate it out into a generic print module, which is called print interpolated. And actually, what will happen to do the translation to Dutch is, you get the language, print interpolated, translate the message ID. So this is the cannot read function name. That's the message ID. Translate it into the domain of that message. There was this table, the table name, and we have the language. Oh, I made a mistake. This parameter should be away. And these are the parameters. So that is function name, and then the file name that I try to open where I died on. So the translate looks it up, and then the print I fills in the parameters which I specified. The colors correspond to what you see above. Actually, this is quite simple. This is nearly the real code. And the print interpolated. It is being used in __x for this message translation infrastructure. You can call it as replacement for printf. And there's also a printp in the same module, which is print positional, which is more close to printf. So let's see what we can do with this thing. Now, one of the things that there are about 40 or 50 printf alternatives on CPAN, but some of them also have the same curly braces syntax for interpolation, but they all lack, either you have this syntax or you have the possibility to have positional parameters, but what you don't have is the combination that you still can use curly braces but also formatting instructions. So this was my first step. I thought, I need this as well in my application. So add formatting in there. But this really opened a lot of creative ideas, which may horrify Guido, because you will see things that there may be other solutions. Some are a bit experimental maybe, and extensions are made. But maybe it gives you ideas as well. It's usable. I have people who are using it for their websites. But maybe you have other ideas for extensions or other syntaxes which make it do the same in a much simpler way. But I will frighten you a bit. One of the things that the interpolation module can do is you can configure it to have modifiers. A modifier is so a global configuration for the printi functions for this for the module. And in this case, I had defined a modifier named pound. And it is mapped to a function which will convert the value which you specified into the value of what you want to be filled in. Say you have the price in cents, euro cents, in your database. So the price is still in euro cents, but you want to have it displayed in pounds. So you can define a function, globally define a function, which converts this pounds, the value conversion and the display conversion, round it into two digits and so on. You can also say by default, if I do not have a value for it anymore, then it's sold out. I'm not really sure that that this will work for all kinds of translations you need to all languages. I'm sure for Western European languages this will be sufficient to have specify a default in this way, but I'm not really sure whether that also works for unknown languages. So in the translation table, if you go back to what I do with translation, I can translate this, the price, which is in English in pounds and by default sold out, into the prize in euro uitverkocht voor Dutch in my Dutch table. And the advantage is that if you usually have to solve this in other frameworks, then you have to write quite a bit of logic. You have to call the right functions. You have to and you have to know more about the language inside your side of your program. But now I only have to define these currencies somewhere in the configuration of that namespace, of that domain, of that text domain, and it's all in the translation table, sort out in the translation tables, not in my program anymore. So that's the advantage, I think. So next to this modifiers, you also can add serializers. So you can also say if I have to fill in a person object, if you specify a person object, I will always insert the name of the person, for instance. So with modifiers and serializers. Maybe you saw a pattern. So inside the curly braces, I added percent and then format instruction, or slash slash and the default. I added something more. This is a quite a common issue, and that was also one of the reasons I started extending this printi function. A friend of me, he has a website which makes psychological tests. And to be able to do the tests as good as possible, as reproducible as possible, then you have to address everyone in the right way. So a woman must always be addressed as a woman, and a man as a man. And sometimes even some things must be formal or informal. It was very sensitive in his environment. He needed the translations, but he needed to be context-aware translations. And this is a very common case. Someone lost his key. Oh yeah, but maybe it's a female. So how do you do it? And well, let's first configure my text domain. This is somewhere in your program. This is the default text domain from this file, for this file, as defined by Lockyport. But you can also specify an explicit text domain which you want to configure in your main program. I configure the context, and in my context of my application, I have genders. And the gender can be male or female, or maybe in some languages unknown, or X. Germany has an X in the passport, isn't it? Male, female, and X nowadays. No gender, something like that. So that might be language dependent. So you can specify this as a default list of options, but you can also have it per language, a different set of options. And then in your runtime, so when you receive a new request for your website, for instance, you set up the context. So this person is, for instance, has gender male. Now how we knit this together? In this translation string, but smaller than, you can say this translation might be gender specific. It might be influenced by gender. Yeah?
Can I interrupt you? I don't get that. How do you translate the is? Because this is actually the thing that has to be changed. Has to be lost his key, lost her key, or lost their key?
Yeah. So, and now I abuse the message context, as you also abused it for the title in your presentation, to specify a context where the translation is effective. So in my message ID now, it automatically generates two translations for me, twice the same message ID, but dependent on the context, it's either in context male or female, we get a different translation. The zijn sleutel or her sleutel, her key or his key.
But that implies you have to translate English as well, otherwise it won't work.
Yep. Yeah. Okay. So you set up, it can even be more complex. You can have more than, for one string, you can have more than one context sensitivity, and it will expand the number of items, it will explode the number of items in the PO table to be translated. But this was it's very useful, and I do not modify the PO file syntax, so it works with the standard translation tools, still works that way. And if you have more than two genders, or if you have something else than gender to select on, so it can be different per language. So in some languages it might explode in three or four, or two or one. In English, everyone is you. So. Okay. We have 10 minutes left, and I'm coming to the subject. So this is our old tricks which are implemented in this printi, which is somewhere hidden in this log report infrastructure for getting translated messages out. How can I use it in Template Toolkit? Well, this is how you use Template Toolkit by default. Anyone who is never using Template Toolkit? Everyone used it before? No? Template Toolkit, you have these template files named TT or TT2 at the end. And then you fill in variables in this template. So it's HTML, and then some fields have to be filled in. I will show you a few examples later. But you start to produce a page by adding a hash of variables to be filled in the pages. And you have some configuration in the beginning. For instance, the search path for where the templates are, and a few more things, a few dozen more things. So actually, it is quite simple to set Template Toolkit up, because it's two lines of code. To add translations, you need a little bit more. Well, actually, the name is a little bit longer, but the configuration parameters are the same, and how you process it is the same. But it's a bit extended. There is one additional function per text domain, so per translation table you are using. You have to say, this is the name of my text domain, the function which will do the translations, and now name it log. In my examples, I will name it log, but from localize, but you can give it any name. Maybe some people prefer a single letter name, because you use it quite a lot in your templates if you start translating. And the directory where all your tables are, the lexicons are. So this is the only thing you have to add. You have to add the specify where are my tables. And every once in a while, this is probably in a PM file somewhere, which is reusable. And every once in a while, you have to call extract, which will run through all the templates you have and update automatically your translation tables. So it finds new strings to be translated. For instance, you do that every day or when you want to. But until you have run extract, you will not be able to fill in your tables. Doesn't matter if you don't fill in your did not fill in your tables, you still get those English texts. So I always start all my programs nowadays with log report and underscore x and so on to be ready to be translated, but I usually do not fill in any translation table yet. So this Template Toolkit, you have this HTML around it, and then you have these constructs to say, okay, somewhere must happen in here. Localize the string hello world. Yeah, this is typically how you, and then somewhere in the PO file is this string. If you're not used to Template Toolkit, often if you need to insert a value, for instance, you have hello world as passed as value with a string in it, then you have to explicitly tell it that it must be HTML encoded, entity encoded, that the smaller than becomes ampersand, LT, colon, and so on. If you forget this in Template Toolkit, then all kinds of horrible output can appear. But this log function is a bit smarter. It knows that it is being used in HTML. So I automatically encode all the entities. Yeah? You can also use it here to fill in variables. The Template Toolkit is a bit like Perl, but not really like Perl. So I have, for instance, a user variable, and it should be used to get the full name. But the user could be a hash, and then full could be a key in that hash, which is named user. But it could also be a function which returns a hash, which has a field full. Or it might be a method, or well, there are many an object, and then full will be a method call on that object. So template toolkit hides all these different kinds of variables. We are so nicely very explicit in Perl, but template toolkit has its own syntax, which looks a little bit like Perl, but really isn't. We don't have pipes in Perl this way. Yeah.
Can one disable this if I want to?
Yes, if you label ends on underscore HTML, it expects it is already encoded.
Okay.
Good question. You're exactly in the right place. So we can do a little bit more because a nice thing of template toolkit is that it can have introspection. But the other thing is that we have this curly brace syntax. And we have already a definition for what percent means and smaller than means. But I added what dot means. So it's a modifier on the thing to be filled in. So instead of specifying you, user full, you can add it here. It is, of course, it's now visible in the translation table that it is dot full. Yeah? Oh, wrong direction. You can also use it this way, useful. I cannot do this in a Perl program for translations because you have no access to the MIs, to the variable names in Perl. After compilation, it's away. You cannot look it up. But in template toolkit, I can look up the namespace and I can just see, oh yeah, the user was defined somewhere. And that saves you a lot of typing. So one of the purposes, you need translations so often, everywhere. So it's very useful to make it very short. As short as possible. Or things like this. So the price, yeah, the product is defined somewhere in the environment. And it might be a hash, might be a function which returns a hash, might be an object which has a price method. I get it. I want to have it formatted in two digits after the dot and by default a dash. So it's quite easy to start using translations now with my module. Very little extra code. You saw this block of 5 lines of extra code. Templates get a little bit more complex, but not that much. You have to call functions. Translations are, it's not only stupid translating, but it really understands that it's producing HTML. And there are some more tricks that I didn't show you, with modifiers and so on. You have to write the configuration only once, and you can use the call extract to get the data from the templates. So it's very practical, and it's also being used in reality, in real websites. And I hope you have ideas and maybe you want to use it as well. I will help you. So that's the talk. Guido.
Actually, one issue with it, you try to make the translation function smart, but one side effect of it is that you leak business logic into the translation files. And that is something that is often frowned upon.
You don't need to use it.
Yeah, you don't need to. Yes, of course. That's the heart of the problem, of the module. And the other thing is, or what I usually tell people is, always absolutely avoid assembling messages in the source code, because sooner or later that will always break. And you made that example with the petal, was it? No, fault, yeah, the fault function. If I understand it correctly, then it automatically interpolates $! into the message. Right?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. And you don't have to go to CJK languages or so to see a problem there. French is enough. In French,
yeah,
you have a space in front of the colon. So if you just do it naively, say this the error message, colon, space.
Yeah.
Then you have an issue there.
No, well, because this is Perl ways of doing it. It has nothing to do with translation. So it's Perl's way to do it.
Yeah, okay, but I mean the next slide. Okay, so where does the error code go? No such thing.
After translation, it will be added there, but also translated into the
language. Colon?
Hmm?
Where does the colon come from that separates it from the actual error message?
Yeah, but it will still produce the same structure as Perl is used, or not what you are used in France in the operating system or something like that.
I'm not sure. I don't think so. I will try it out and I will write you.
Yeah, but one of the very nice thing about so using fault here is that the error code is collected, but it's not yet translated. So if the fault message goes to Chinese on the website, it will be $! translated into Chinese, and when it goes to the log file which has dispatched at the same time, and which logs into in English, it will have $! in English.
Yes.
I think I understand what you mean, but okay. But we will do it on paper together. So. More questions? Okay, and that's it.
Thank you.